This is a Worlds Awaiting web exclusive where Rachel Wadham sits down with educator and author Mary Bigler to talk about how adults can keep their kids reading during the summer months.
We're talking with Mary today. Welcome to the show, Mary.
Hello, Rachel. I'm delighted to have an opportunity to visit with you.
Oh, it is always a joy to visit with you because I think we are both passionate about so many things. We share our passions of learning and literacy and reading. But one of the things that we are really advocates for, and you in particular are a great advocate for, is summer reading. So tell us, why do you think summer reading is so important?
Well, you know, it's absolutely critical that we keep children reading during the summer, Rachel. I say just because the school doors are closed doesn't mean reading and learning should stop. We've known for a long time as educators that in the summer, children experience what we call the summer slide, or in other words, they regress in their reading. When we test children in June and then retest the same children in September, they've lost ground. They've gone backwards. The average student loses about 1 month of instruction during the summer, and some students, unfortunately, can lose up to about 3 months of reading achievement over the summer if they don't read. But the good news is that if children keep reading, they can maintain their level that they achieved in the preceding school year. And all they have to do to do that, according to the research, is read about 6 books over the summer break. So I, of course, like to say, well, if we can read 6 books and maintain what we had, why don't we read 12 books or 15 books and gain some ground and become better readers over the summer? So that's why I think it's so important for all of us to encourage children to read over the summer.
Mary, I couldn't agree with you more. I think that summer slide is really something that is significant. And I don't think a lot of parents or adults or maybe even teachers or librarians to that extent really understand how significant this regression is and then how hard it is for them to get back when they go back into school. So very simple things we can do as parents to help students read over the summer. So what are some of your suggestions that we can do to help them engage in reading?
Okay, I like to start with what I call ABC, because that's a very simple thing for parents and teachers and interested adults to remember. A, children need access to reading materials. We know that you don't learn to swim if you don't have a lake or a swimming pool or a creek near your house. Well, you don't learn to read and become a good reader if you don't have access to reading materials. So first of all, we need to make sure that we have reading material available for our children. That's the A, access. B are books, books that match children's interests and their reading levels. We know that if children are involved in something that they care about and enjoy reading, it's a lot easier to get them to read than if we're forcing them to read something that they don't care about. And that's true with adults also. So we want to make sure that we have materials available that match their interests and also their reading levels. So if a child is reading approximately at a third grade level, we can't expect them to be reading books that are written up very much above that. Otherwise, it'll be frustrating for them. So the B stands for books that match their interest and reading levels. And then C is to make sure that the children are comprehending. And we sometimes, as the adult, have to help them check their comprehension to make sure that they're understanding what they read. So if we follow that, A, B, C, that we have access to books and reading materials, that we have material that matches their interests and reading levels, and we make sure that they're understanding it, I think that's our best chance to keep them reading and actively engaged with reading all summer, as well as through the rest of the school year.
That is a wonderful way to look at it, Mary. I really appreciate you breaking it down that way. But let's break it down a little bit more. Let's start with the A. When we talk about access, what ways can we help our children get access to books, especially during the summer?
Yes, a lot of thoughts about that. First of all, let's remember our public libraries. We are so blessed to live in a country where we have libraries available to us. And libraries give us access to books and magazines, CDs, audiobooks, ebooks. And They also offer additional opportunities for children to be engaged with literary activities. They offer story hours, and they have reading incentive programs where children might read a certain number of books and then have a reward of some kind. They feature displays of new books that are popular with children. They have author visits where you can go and listen to an author talk about writing, and that sometimes gets kids interested in reading that author's works. And they have book clubs. And librarians are wonderful resources for parents and children to consult because they know children and they know books, they know what's popular, and they can introduce the kids to books that they may not find on their own. And incidentally, if I could make a plea to any school administrator or teacher or any interested citizen out there in our listening audience, I would really like to think that if we're the richest country in the world, can't we have our school library open at least one half day a week during the summer?
Hear, hear.
I know it would cost some money, but I'm confident there'd be many teachers and parents who would volunteer to staff it. And really, the school library is too valuable a resource to be sitting idle for 3 months. And some children don't have access to a public library. They may not have the transportation or the way to get there, but they might be able to get to their school library. So I'd really like, to, as citizens, to say, you know, we need to utilize this wonderful resource and make it more available to children in the summertime. I have a quote. Leslie Conger made a great statement. She said, "The best of my education has come from reading. You don't need to know very much to start with if you know your way to the library."
Yay! I love that quote.
I love that quote. And today, you know, of course, with the technology, we almost have the library at our fingertips. And it is possible to know more about any given topic than we've ever known before. So in terms of access, we have the technology and we have these wonderful public libraries that we certainly can connect with children to encourage them to read.
Yeah, I love that sense. And as you well know, I'm a big advocate for libraries and agree, you know, if we extend the school lunch program into the summer, forget kids' food during the school year, why not open the library too? You know, yes. The school's already open. There's people there. We might as well do that. So I am a big advocate for that. And, you know, as much as I love libraries, and I really agree with you, they're a great resource, that doesn't negate, I think, in my mind, though, having actual physical books in our home and having access directly in home. So could you speak to that, maybe something about how you feel about access with books just that are ours, that are in our home, our own home libraries?
Yes, and that is a very important component. In fact, one of the recommendations I often make to parents is to read a book together as a family. And if you have children of various ages, let's say you have a 3, a 6, a 9, and a 12-year-old, there are books that they all would enjoy. The Velveteen Rabbit, or Charlotte's Web, or The Boxcar Children. There are both fiction and nonfiction books that young children and older children and we adults would enjoy reading together. So in building a home library, I always kind of look for those classic books. And, you know, you can go to garage sales and flea market and secondhand stores, and sometimes you can pick up a book for a quarter or 50 cents. Sometimes libraries sell their excess books, and if you can go there and get treasures for a quarter that can become part of your family library and that you will read again and again with the children. So I encourage parents to read these wonderful treasures to the kids. And another important point is to let children choose what they want to read, and especially during the summer. Because, you know, during the school year, a lot of the reading that children do, they have to do. They're required to do. So in the summer, we've got more freedom for children to select the books they would like to read. So 92% of children say they're more likely to finish a book that they've picked out themselves. So when children say they want a particular book, maybe your school does the school book clubs where you can order books for a reasonable price, or maybe your child expresses an interest in a book that a teacher has read out loud, acquire that book, buy that book, give books as gifts to your children, and then say to the youngsters, let's all of us read every day for 30 to 60 minutes. Because if we would read 30 to 60 minutes every single day during the summer, we could read those 12 books that we would like to read in order to improve our reading. At least read the 6 so we don't slide backwards. And so when children express interest in a book or an author, I think parents and grandparents and interested adults, some aunts, uncles, cousins, whoever is buying gifts for that child, bring those books into the home so that, again, we do build a home library that has reading material that children really will value.
I love that. And that connects to that B, and you've already kind of covered this, but I'd really like to delve into that a little bit more, because I think a lot of times, sometimes we think as adults that what interests us will interest our kids, and that we try to push books on them in a way that maybe will not be as beneficial to our kids. So how can we as adults really find those kinds of books that will interest our children at that level to keep them reading over the summer?
You know, I think anything that kids are doing regularly that they choose to do is probably where their interests are. And so if we can tie their interests with good books and magazines, we've kind of solved the motivation problem. So, for example, if you've got children who love to play sports and they are on a traveling soccer team, or they enjoy shooting hoops in the park or in the driveway, then find books about basketball and soccer. There are many children's authors that write sports books for children. And if they have a natural interest in a sport, then tie that to a reading activity. If they love animals, and many of our children love animals, and they love going to the zoo, then we get a hold of books by Steve Jenkins or Seymour Simon, who write these wonderful books of animals. If they just like to go for walks or hikes in the mountains, we can read books like Tommy DiPaolo's The Cloud Book, because after you go for a walk and you're talking about what cloud formations you saw, then you read a book about that. Simple everyday tasks like going on a bus ride, and then we would read Wheels on the Bus. If we go to a concert, children enjoy music, and a lot of our youngsters take music lessons. We should be reading biographies of famous musicians like Duke Ellington. Many of our youngsters are so into the video and computer games. And in those games, they encounter mythology, castles, geography, maps. So use those video games as motivation to read books like Rupert Matthews' book, Knights and Castles, or David Macaulay's book, Cathedral, or Neil Phillips' book, The Illustrated Book of Myths. Because if they encounter those things in the video game, they're curious and they want more information, and then the book will supply much more depth than the video game can supply. If your little one likes Dora the Explorer, there are a whole series of books featuring Dora. If they enjoy movies, find a book that goes with the movie. Right now, Steven Spielberg's The BFG, based on Roald Dahl's book, and we all know the popularity of movies like Frozen and Star Wars have inspired children to read the books these movies are based on. In other words, we kind of know what children are doing and what they're enjoying, and we, as the adult or parent or a figure in their life who care about reading, will say, hey, I'm going to use that to motivate them to read.
I love that sense, because it's interesting to me, even though we're talking today about summer reading and we're trying to address the needs of students of reading over the summer, the reality is that all of this we're talking about is really making literacy activities and reading in particular just an integral part of our daily activities. So in some ways, what we're talking about extends beyond just the summer. This is stuff that we really should be doing on a daily basis every day. It's an integral part of who our family should be.
Absolutely. The thing is that during the school year, I think families are very pressured. There's so many obligations, and there's so many meetings and places they need to be, both the adults and the children. And sometimes they don't have time to do as much with literacy activities as they do have time during the summer. So you're right, these things are certainly things we should be doing regularly as part of our literary lives. I just think that sometimes we get so busy with so many activities during the school year that we don't do as much as we have the opportunity to do during the summer.
I love that. But before we close, let's touch a little bit on our C about comprehension. What are some important things that parents in particular can do to just quickly assess the comprehension of their children as they're reading?
That is such a great question, Rachel, and that is a question I'm probably asked more frequently by parents when I go around the country doing parent programs than any other question. And there are several little quick suggestions here. One is, normally, your child will evidence whether he's comprehending or not, because if the book is too hard, generally the children will give up reading it. If it's too easy, they get bored and they probably aren't going to complete it. So generally, I just watch and see if the children seem engaged in the book, and if they are, they're probably comprehending. They're not going to usually sit there and pretend that they're involved in understanding it when they're not. Also, when they're done reading a chapter or when they've finished their half hour or hour reading or they're tired of reading, ask them about what they just read. If they can summarize and tell you what they just read, then you obviously know they're comprehending it. And engage the children in questioning like, well, what would you have done if you'd have been in that circumstance? Or did you like the way the story ended? Or how else could the character have handled that? That shows that they're thinking. And if they can answer those questions, then surely they're understanding it. But one technique that I use a lot as a teacher, and I certainly recommend to parents, is something developed years ago by an educator named Jeanette Veach, and it's called the five-finger technique. This is very simple, but it is so effective. When a child selects a book they think they want to buy or take from the library or they're interested in reading, you open up to any page in the book, usually kind of in the middle of the book, and you tell the child to read the page. Now, this is like in a chapter book where there are a lot of words. Every time they come across a word they don't know, they put up a finger. And when they come across a second word they don't know, they put up a second finger. If they get five fingers up on one page, it probably is a book they should wait and read later. In other words, that might be a little difficult for them. Because if there's approximately 100 words on a page and you don't know five of them, that's probably going to interfere with your comprehension. But if they've got one, two, or three fingers up, they should be able to read that with no problem. So that's a real easy, quick way to decide whether it's a good fit in terms of if they're going to understand the book. But I never would tell a student they couldn't read a book. Incidentally, we just had a contest in one of our local schools where the children had to write about the value of books. And a little six-year-old boy named Andrew won. And I want to read what he said. I think it's one of the most profound statements of all time. Little six-year-old Andrew wrote, "Books let me see the whole world when my mom won't even let me cross the street."
Beautiful.
Isn't that profound? I thought that was fabulous. There are so many benefits to being a good reader. We develop empathy and we encounter new ideas and we're exposed to beauty and humor and truth and joy, and our tastes and interests are broadened and our imaginations are developed. So I tell the youngsters that the readers of today are going to be the leaders of tomorrow. Because when we read, we have access to all the accumulated wisdom from all of the great minds of the past. So how blessed we are to have access to books and magazines and the technology that today will allow us to know what all the great minds of the past have thought about. It's a fabulous thing to be a reader.
I think that is the most beautiful way to sum all this up. You know, what more could you want than great travels in the summer? Summer and traveling are analogous, so let's travel and expand our horizons beyond of crossing
That's
the street
right.
when we start to read. It's such an amazing thing, and I appreciate your insight and your words, and I appreciate you letting us get to know the ABCs of summer reading.
Well, I agree 100%, and I think if we give the gift of literacy, we've given them the best academic gift we could give.
Without a doubt. Thank you so much, Mary. This has been delightful speaking with you. I have just enjoyed every moment of it, and I know our listeners out there have just enjoyed gaining all this wonderful new insight.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed it also.